of this exciting conference. You know, one of the good things of this conference is that of the many good things, that's a short close. One of the many good things of this conference is that it reveals very clearly the significance of religion. The fact that religion and religious freedom is not only relevant and important for religious people, but for society at large. And it touches upon a very big variety of subjects that are the main topics of the different sessions. When I knew I was in charge of chairing this session, religion and environment, the first thing that came to my mind was the fact that there is, it's, this association, religion and environment, is not frequent at all, at least in the West. People, normally environmentalists, normally they don't create this link between the issue of religion and the issue of protection of the environment, which is surprising, but when we come to think of that, yesterday Cole Durham was talking about the ambivalence of the sacred, and we could speak about the ambivalence of men in their relationship with nature, with the universe. There is this ambivalence. On the one hand, we are humankind is dominator of nature, and on the other hand, it's part of nature. And this kind of ambivalence is very well grasped by religions. This idea that you may be the main protagonist of history and of nature, but at the same time, you have to respect it, because you are part of it, part of this system. Religions very often, and other decent philosophies of life, they help understand the fact that men are not the navel of the universe, as we are sometimes used to be, especially in Western cultures, where we have developed this kind of individualistic culture that we think we are everything in the world, and this is not true at all. So this moral dimension of the relationship between mankind and nature is very well understood normally by religion. So that is why I think that this topic was very relevant for this conference. We are in a tight schedule, as you know, because I assume that you prefer to eat lunch instead of eating the time we have available for lunch. And then I would ask the speakers to be very respectful of the time they have allocated. We have the advantage, it was a sad event, but one of the main speakers in this session couldn't make it to Hyderabad. So we can compensate the delay in the beginning of this session with the time he had available. So it's not that you have more time because he's missing. You will have the same time. Right, that's right. So you will have like between 15 and 20 minutes, and the rest of the speakers, please, no more than 10 minutes. So I will give the floor first to Swami Agnivesh. I will skip the introductions because we all have them in the program, and that will help us save in some time.
ओम बिस्मिल्लाहिर रहमानिर रहीम एट द आउटसेट आई इनवोक द ब्लेसिंग्स ऑफ अल्लाह गॉड ईश्वर परमात्मा वाहेगुरु हु इज ऑल मर्सीफुल एंड ऑल वेरी कंपैशनेट आई हैव ए mantra to recite from the Rig Veda. The meaning is that all of us human beings who constitute one family, we should all walk together, talk together, and walk the talk together, and share the bounties of Mother Earth in the spirit of sharing and caring, not plundering and self-aggrandizement. The mantras I will recite, and after that I will say what I have to say. Sangha Chadvam Samvada Dvam संवो मनांसि जानताम देवा भागम यथा पूर्वे संजनाना उपासते समानो मंत्र समिति समानी समानं मनस चित्तमेषां समान मंत्रं अभिमंत्रयेव समानेन वो हविषा जुहोमि The purport of these mantra is that the entire earth belongs to the people and the people have equal right over all natural resources. Equal right, all people have equal right over natural resources, over earth, land, water, forest, mineral and all these resources. And these must be shared in the spirit of sharing and caring. And we should go by a need-based economy and not a greed-based economy. Now, friends, much as I look like a religious person dressed in this orange, let me tell you that I have very little to do with any organized, institutionalized religion. So I don't call myself a Hindu or a Muslim or a Christian or a Jew or anything. I've been a socio-spiritual human rights activist. And for the last 48 years I have been fighting for the rights of the poorest of the poor in India and in South Asia and world over. Those who are victims of modern-day slavery. We call them bonded laborers, bonded child labor in our country. There are laws, but they are not being implemented. And there are legal luminaries sitting here, and the vice chancellor sitting here. I would like to pose a question. Why is the law, why is the constitution not being implemented? Who do you hold accountable for that? The government, the politicians, the officers, or who? The Supreme Court of India gave a landmark historic judgment in my case where I was the petitioner about bonded laborers in the stone quarries in the brick kilns in North India. That case is being taught in law colleges as part of the course, Bandhua Mukti Morcha versus Union of India and others. But let me tell you that that judgment has not been implemented even after 35 years. It was delivered on 16th of December 1983 and that remains unimplemented. And the subject matter of this judgment are not far removed from the Supreme Court or from our federal parliament, hardly 20 kilometers south of our parliament and Supreme Court. And yet, that's not being implemented. And the Supreme Court judges had said that we will take very serious view if this is not implemented, but they have not taken any view, let alone serious view. Otherwise, heads would have rolled and something, some impact would have been there. So what I find today is that we talk about law, we talk about religion, we talk about development, but the poorest of the poor have been left completely at the mercy of the rich and the powerful. And therefore, I question the religion in which I was born into. I question all of these legal professions. I was myself a lawyer in Calcutta High Court under Sabyasachi Mukherjee, who later on became the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of India. I taught law in universities, but then I got disenchanted and I left in 1968 to work among the poorest of the poor, so that I can organize them, galvanize them, unionize them, and see to it that law is implemented in their favor. Having said that, Let me tell you a story, real life story about the then president of the World Bank. When he first came as president of the World Bank to Delhi to preside over a meeting in his office on Lodhi Road, Delhi, I was out on the street, other side of the road, holding a placard, "Go back." Why? Because I felt World Bank policies, that of IMF and WTO, they are hitting hard our poorest of the poor. They are displacing. The big dam which was going to be built or still being built, Narmada Sagar or Sardar Sarovar Dam, was going to displace hundreds and thousands of our poor indigenous people. So I was shouting his slogans, "Go back, go back." But this World Bank president was a different person. He opened the window, saw us shouting slogans, thought that we were angry, invited us inside over a cup of tea and wanted to know why were we angry. And when we told him that, "Look, this is your policy, you have sanctioned this much of a loan to the government of India, and which is going to destroy the flora, the fauna, and everything, including the livelihood of the poorest of the poor." He listened to us, went back to his office in Washington, D.C., and canceled the loan. To our great surprise, we didn't expect a World Bank president to respond to the cries of the poor. And then he invited me to his office, thinking that I was a religious person, which I was not, and 30 all top directors sitting, and he in front, and me on the other side of the table. He said, "Swami, why are you so critical of our globalization?" I said, "Mr. President, your globalization is nothing but glorification of greed as God." He was a bit stunned and said, "What do you mean?" I said, "Yes, you have glorified greed. Greed, without greed, there can be no business. Maximization of profit, what does it mean? It means greed. Fulfilling your greed, not maximization of your needs, fulfilling your needs, no, your greed." And Gandhi had famously said that the whole earth, Mother Earth, can fulfill everybody's needs, but cannot fulfill or satisfy even one person's greed. And I said, "In what sense you say that?" I say, "Yes, because globalization means privatization. Privatization of what? Natural resources. Natural resources belong to all the 7 billion people of this Mother Earth. We are the children. Vedas say, Mata Bhumim Putroham Prithivya. Mother is, Earth is our mother, and we are its children. If we are the children of this Mother Earth, we have equal rights over the resources of Mother Earth. You cannot privatize the natural resources, water, forest, mineral wealth, and so on and so forth, and give it to some corporates to maximize their profit. Profit may be acceptable, but not profiteering." And I said, "In your scheme of globalization, everything is a market. In a marketplace, all these natural resources have been commodified, and commodities have a price tag, and the rich and the powerful throw the money and buy over the natural resources. We don't accept it from our ethical, moral, spiritual value system. We cannot sell, we cannot buy these natural resources. They belong to us. Just as God has given us life, God has given us all these natural resources so that life could be beautiful. So it has to be taken in the spirit of sharing and caring only." And then he was shocked and said, "What do you mean? What is the alternative?" I said, "We have an alternative in our ancient system. We call it Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam." Now, Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, this particular thing finds place in our central hall of federal parliament in Delhi. It says, "Ayam nija paro veti ganana lagu chetasam udar charitanam tu Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam." This is mine and this is thine. This is the way of the small-hearted people. Those who are large-hearted, for them, the entire universe or entire earth is a family, one family. So he said, "Fine, one family. So what's the difference? Globalization, world, one world family, is the same." I said, "No. Here the most powerful takes all the natural resources for profiteering. In the family, it is the smallest child, the weakest child in the family, who claims and takes his or her share the first, and the breadwinner of the family takes his or her share the last. This is a spiritual paradigm. Bring about this spiritual paradigm the world over. Let the poorest of the poor in the world get their share of development first, and then only the richest of the rich should get last. No problem. Said, how that can be possible? I said, yes, it can be possible. In the name of globalization, you have forced our third world or poorer countries to lower their customs wall so that your goods, your capital can enter into our countries, make profit and go back, make them richer. But if you want us to make the mobility of capital and goods free mobility, then also allow free mobility of labor. Allow us also to move to your countries, your places. Don't give us voting rights or citizenship right, but at least give us equal right to move wherever we like, wherever we can make a living. So I could see their faces, they were all trembling. Oh, what do you mean? What do you mean? I said, yes, I mean it, and one day it's going to happen. I shared with them this movie which was shown then by British BBC Channel 4, in which an African Gandhi was leading a 50 million crowd of hungry and starving people into the Mediterranean and into the Europe. And a journalist, lady journalist, was sent by these powers to stop them. And this lady journalist goes with her mic, said, why are you marching towards Europe? She said, we see nice good things over there. So, what do you want? We want to go there and live happily there. She said, no. Why don't you stay here? No, we are here very poor. Why are you poor? And this Gandhian, African Gandhi-like figure says, because you are rich. Because you are rich, we are poor. Friends, having put this in perspective, I would like to request you that please join hands in a big way. I enjoyed all these yesterday in morning session here. I thank you, Faizan Mustafa Sahab. I thank BYU Law. I made a couple of friends while traveling here. And I want that this is a great historic moment for us to join hands and heads together to fight this dehumanizing poverty in the world. Sustainable goals, number one, fighting poverty. In what way? Fighting hunger. I was in Rome recently. The UN invited me. I'm also on the board of directors of King Abdullah bin Abdullah Aziz International Intercultural Dialogue Center in Vienna. In that capacity, they had invited me there. From here, I will be going to Switzerland for Davos, this World Economic Forum. And everywhere I put this question squarely. And I ask, why in this day and time, every day, 21,000 people should die of hunger and starvation? Tell me. Why should 21,000 people should die every day of starvation? The food production is not less. It can meet the demands, needs of more than 1.5 times of the world population. But children are dying. Innocent young children are dying. Mostly in India and South Asia and Sub-Saharan Africa. Every 4 seconds a child is dropping dead. This is the UN figure. Food and Agricultural Ministry Organization, FAO, 21,000 dying every day. And we are feeding the cattle, the pigs, all the food grain to fatten them, to get more profit out of them. Is this business ethics? And you want us to be satisfied with their corporate social responsibility of 2% or 2.5%?